from the heart of America in Chicago, Illinois.
It's time for Roker Radio with Al Roker Jr. And now, Al Roker Jr.
How you doing, everybody? Welcome to another edition of Roker Radio. Al Roker Jr., glad to be back with you. Boy, am I glad to be back with you. It's like that old joke. I'm glad to be here. I'm glad to be anywhere. What a world we are living in now. Dano with me, as usual, via Zoom. How you doing, Dano?
This is cool, man. What a first, huh?
I guess it is a first, huh? First of many, probably. I don't think either of us are going anyplace anytime soon.
Hey, man, is that how, like, cavemen had their, like, first podcast? They would just, like, grunt and moan in their caves as they're locked up for, like, 4 months, like bears?
That's it.
Like, hello, do you love me? Yes, I will crack rock on your head.
We're hibernating for the spring.
We're like bears.
It's unbelievable.
We're like bears in Canada, where we're like, we poke our heads out to get our, like, GoPuff and Instacart orders, and then we go back in, and we're like, holy shit, it's not time yet.
You're right, and then you didn't just pop back in.
Yeah, we're like, no, we're good. It's still cold out.
How are you?
But, hey, I could get used to this shit. I mean, what? Like, maybe if it started a little earlier, maybe, like, January to May, I'd be kind of cool with it annually.
But it's a little bit, yeah, right. Well, it's going to be interesting, you know, as we record this, it's early April, and we all know that we're going to be, stuck at home at least until the end of April. So it's going to be very interesting to see what happens once the weather actually gets nice outside. If people are going to be able to stay inside, if people are going to be able to continue their social distancing, continue to stay at home. Let me say on behalf of everyone who is, high risk, or they've got a immune deficiency or whatever, please stay at home. Please social distance. I haven't been outside in, at this point, it's 21 days and counting. And I have no plans on going outside because the only way that I can not guarantee, but the only way that I can feel comfortable about not catching this virus is if I don't go outside and catch the virus. I went outside. The last time I was out was the week before St. Patrick's Day. I went out and I early voted. I ran some errands. I went to the grocery store. I got gas. I went to Kohl's. And then that Friday was the last day I left the house. Saturday was the day that J.B. Pritzker had his little press conference, and he was pissed off that everyone was lining up at the bars downtown for St. Patrick's Day weekend. And the next day is when he closed the restaurants and closed the bars.
Yeah.
And then Tuesday was election day. Did you end up voting?
Nah, bro. I had to go to Arlington Heights to vote. So that was a niche.
So had this coronavirus thing been going on, you would have gone out there and voted?
Sure.
Probably not. Yeah, just for the purposes of this podcast. Yeah, sure. You would have gone out there and voted. Yeah, so that was the last day. The last day I went outside was the Friday before Election Day, just to give you an idea. So it's been a while. Now, I've got a big house here, and I've got a big yard. So if I want to. Now, you don't understand, Dano. I haven't even gone outside. I went outside on the porch once. For about 4 minutes. That's the only time I've been outside in the last 3 weeks.
I'm kind of disgusted by you, because not in like, oh, Roke's a piece of shit, but you have
That's usually how you feel about me.
Stop it. No, dude. I was like, bro, you have so much land. Like, listen, don't be scared to go outside. Obviously, keep your distance on, like, who's around you or what's going on. But, bro, you got to go outside. Get some fresh air and get some vitamin D. What they're saying, I'm sure we'll get into the whole nitty-gritty, but some of the people that are getting hit by this shit, it's their immune systems that are weak, but they're also vitamin D non-efficient. So they have low levels of vitamin D, and for fucking some reason, this virus likes to, like, attract to people who don't have that antibody, that vitamin in their system.
Well, I
so
take
going
I take
outside and getting sun is good.
Well, there actually wasn't a lot of sun in March anyway to get. It was one of the cloudiest Marches in history. I take vitamin D anyway, so I take vitamin D and, like, prenatal pills and stuff like that. That's why I have such.
You're pregnant.
That's why I have such luscious breasts. when I want to go outside and get some air, I'll go outside and get some air. But I don't have a real problem with staying inside. It doesn't.
Bro, the only time you go get some air is when fucking your, like, donut delivery shows up.
And I didn't go out to get that. That was a delivery. I had Claire go to the door and get that.
I'm sure you did. I'm sure fucking Claire does everything.
Well, But the thing is, the way I feel about it is, like, the only way I'm going to catch this is if she brings it into the house. So I don't.
Nice pressure building on fucking your wife.
Well, no, I don't. I really don't want her to go. I want her to go out as little as possible. And when she has had to go out, like, she's gone out and, like, gotten food a couple of times. And she's had to go out and get, like, pick up prescriptions and stuff like that because when she got laid off, she worked in the hotel restaurant industry. So she got laid off like a day after he closed the restaurants and bars. She got laid off. And so we lost our health insurance on the 31st. So we spent, like, that 10 days trying to get every prescription. She spent those 10 days getting every prescription we have filled. So she had to run to CVS.
Like Viagra.
That's exactly
Cialis.
Right. Just the important stuff.
All the narcotics.
Right. Tramadol.
Opiates.
Right. And so she had to go to CVS a couple of times because they wouldn't deliver it because they were new prescriptions and stuff like that. But, you know, while she was out, she would, like, grab some milk, grab cheese, grab bread, whatever. But, like, and I got to be honest with you, like, the people at CVS, like, the pharmacist at CVS, she was great, you know. She was trying to get the prescriptions delivered. She was telling her that the store isn't busy right now. There's hardly anybody here. So now's a good time to come, that kind of stuff. And I'm telling Claire, now, when you go, I want you to take a wipe with you. I want you to have a wipe on your hand when you open the door. Have a wipe here when you touch the thing. He goes, well, the door's open automatically, so I don't have to touch the door. I'm like, okay, well, have a wipe in your hand when you take anything off of the counter, whatever. I said, when you get home, spray the bag down, spray the doorknob. When people deliver stuff to the house, I'm like, spray that bag down, spray the doorbell, all that stuff.
I got a new, like, new thing, so I'm going to call it for our podcast.
Yes.
I want to do a video of it, but here's our future. You ready for it?
Yeah, I don't know if I'm ready for our future.
So I was, like, freaking out, right, because I got a couple, like, the stop soap, like, you know, like, caramel, not caramel, it was just, like, soft skin, like, all the, like, little, like, push bottles of soap.
Right.
And then the little ones were, like, 99 cents, so they started, like, kind of, like, they don't last that long. And I thought it was going to be a month. Then it's a second month. And I was, like, freaking out. I thought I didn't have a refill, but I do. But in that meantime, I remembered that I bought a bunch of, like, bath soap, that Irish Spring shit, because it was cheap. And I was like, worst case scenario, I could trade it when the shit hits the fan, or I could throw it at somebody, whatever.
You
but
can
now,
trade it.
Shut up, bro. The shit might still hit the fan. Get ready. But no, at one point, like, they said that, like, soap and alcohol kills this thing. So I basically, now when I come home or we get an Amazon package or when we get groceries delivered, I literally lather up my hands like a doctor And then I just scrub the shit out of everything that comes, whether it's fruit, vegetables, boxes, Amazon, like cardboard, etc. And basically just lather it up with soap, and that'll kill all the germs.
Well, and that's exactly what you do. As a matter of fact, I'm glad you brought that up, because I was on a Zoom, you know, like a Zoom conference, video conference today with Senator Dick Durbin, our alderman, which is a woman, representative from the House of Representatives, but also a doctor who is a, what is it, endocrinologist?
Yeah.
An endocrinologist from the University of Chicago. And so I'm going to play some audio from that video conference. So we're going to hear from the endocrinologist about the virus, how you catch the virus, how you should be acting when you're in public, what you should be doing with your groceries. I'm going to let you hear from Senator Dick Durbin, and he's going to talk about all the stuff that was in that $2 trillion stimulus bill that they passed. We're going to talk to somebody who works for the Illinois Department of Commerce and Economic Opportunity. She's going to talk about the small business loans that you can get. And she and Congressman Robin Kelly are also going to talk about, because a lot of people have lost their jobs. You've seen the unemployment numbers. They're the highest that they've been in the history of unemployment. She's going to talk about filing for unemployment and exactly what you get, what you should be getting. So
cool.
I've got all that audio that I want to play for you. I noticed that my lovely wife, Claire, has bogarted our Zoom session. Hello, Claire. Hello. How are you, baby?
I just noticed that shit now.
I love you.
I'm good. How are you?
I'm okay. Is there anything that you want to add?
No, I'm like up
all
to
all right.
Here
thanks a lot. Night. Thanks for joining us. Appreciate it.
Wait, no, hold on. Claire, what was it that you were saying that you had up to hear about what? Like, listening to
you have to understand, she never, never watches the news. She has watched more news in the last 3 weeks than she has watched in the 26 years we've been married. And the only reason that she's watched it is because I'm watching it.
Watch.
And she, yeah, that's all I have on. So
it's either Corona or porn. There's no in between.
Pretty much.
I mean, it's kind of the same thing, no?
No, it's not even close.
Porn at least is enjoyable.
Not even close.
Wow. Yeah. I was about to say the Corona could fuck you if you get it. So
well, that's true.
Yes, but that's not enjoyable.
That's not enjoyable. Yes, exactly.
Yeah, I gotcha.
But those are the only two things that Corona and the porn have in common. So,
well, no, like before you play those files, Roke, but like, yeah. I'm glad you guys listened to that shit, because I kind of had to chew both of you out via text a couple times, because Claire's like, oh, honey, do you want me to do a pit stop for you? Do you need anything? I got to go to a store. I was like, Claire, first of all, you ain't got to get shit. I was like, the prescriptions, I get it, but you still need to figure out something with that. I'm sure caviar is some bullshit. You will pick up your delivery. You know what? You got to do a Postmates to fucking CVS, and then in the instructions, tell them to fucking pick up your prescription, and you'll give them a $10 tip.
Well, here's what happened, because she was on, because most of the prescriptions I get are mail order, so 90% of the prescriptions that I got, and there are a lot of them, they were sent here mail order, but there were a few that would not have gotten here on time before our insurance ran out. So we had to get them at CVS, and because they were first-time CVS prescriptions, they had to be picked up. They couldn't be delivered.
Wow.
So that's the only reason. And CVS was great, by the way. Clary
Baroque, like, fucking A, man. Like, you have, like, 190 apps. Most of your memory are apps. And the truth of the matter is you could get just about everything delivered. So at this point, Claire should not be fucking getting bread, whether she's picking up prescriptions or just doing a pit stop, because you could get something within 12 hours or fucking 36 hours delivered to you, hook the guy up with a tip, order a ton of shit. I just put in an order for $240 at Aldi. We're giving their asses a $30 tip.
How the hell do you spend $240 at Aldi?
Like a fucking champ. I got ribeyes. I got pasta. Bro, we got wines. Dude, I think we got, like, cheesecake platters. Oh, dude, we're going to fucking, like, make some food for the, like, local, like, fire department or hospital.
You're like, if I'm going to be stuck inside for 45 days, I'm going to be living it up like a king, huh?
Dude, fucking bunker hill, man. I'm like a bear. Bears hibernate. So check this shit out. We'll get into it. But it, like, I went crazy the last, like, 2 weeks, like, eating and, you know, I think wine o'clock started at, like, 6 o'clock every day.
Yeah, right. At the very least, wine o'clock, yes.
Dude, like, fucking the carbs add up. Sitting at home adds up. But I have to, like, start fasting again because, you know, I've been doing that shit. And it's just, like, felt bloated and just eating during the day was different, man. I hadn't done that in a year.
It's going to be very hard for you to fast while you're at home. I've been telling Claire, and it's hard, I told her, because I've been home for a while, but I'm like, you know, you need to try and get a routine together. And there was a psychologist on with this conference call as well, and he said the exact same thing. You need to get a routine. You need to exercise. You need to get into a routine. And if you feel anxiety, if you feel stress, that's okay, because you're going to feel anxiety and you're going to feel stress. Just don't get all stressed out about it and all anxious because of it, because it's normal.
So that me and Michelle broke up today.
Go ahead, Claire.
I said there's going to be a lot of suicides because of this.
Yeah, no, it's going to be a little, well, fuck. I just read a story in Pennsylvania that a husband shot his wife in the back because he just got laid off. And then he shot himself in the head, killed himself. She survived because he shot at her 4 times and only shot her once, and she survived. So, like, the shit's starting.
And they talked about in this conference meeting about wife beating, you know, domestic violence. Can you?
Yeah, don't get any ideas.
Dude, but can you imagine that you're in? I mean, thank God I'm in a good relationship. Can you imagine you're in a bad relationship or you're in an abusive relationship and now you can't leave the house? Can you imagine that? So
Michelle wanted to beat my ass today and shit like that. Like, I mean, the tensions are starting where, you know, we're in a confined spot. Like, what do we have, like, probably like 700 square feet here? So I don't know, man. There's tiffs and stuff like that. There's no point that I've ever gotten where I was like, fucking, I hate this person. But it's like, I could see it slowly developing. Like, you're in each other's space and shit over long periods of time. God help you if you, like, listen, like, between us, like, you guys have some, like, you know, I don't know how much you want to talk about it, but more things to think about when it comes to finances and shit. But, like, I could see people having a lot of bills, having some shit to pay, and the tensions run higher.
That's where we are.
Boils.
And I told her, I said, look, I said, we could go crazy worrying about bills and taxes and unemployment and all that kind of stuff until we're blue in the face. All we really need to do right now is just stay safe. Because the last thing we need on top of all this shit is for one of us or both of us to get sick. So the only thing we need to focus on right now is staying healthy and staying safe. And that's the advice I would give to everyone listening to Roker Radio right now, is I know you've got a lot of stresses. I know you've got a lot of financial problems. Everyone's in the same boat. It sucks. It's like, I'll be watching, like, Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives, right? I'll be watching, like, the Food Network, right? And Guy Fieri will be at some pizza place in, like, Denver, Colorado. And I'm like, they're closed. Or they'll be at some famous place, you know? I'm like, oh, they're closed. Everyone's closed. Everyone's in the same boat. Everyone is in the same boat. And I just want to say, for the record, thank you to all the people out there who still have to work. And when we hear the term essential workers, we think about first responders, fire, police, the medical personnel. But we don't think about the truck drivers, all those people at the grocery store.
Oh, yeah.
Who
it's
are getting,
card, fucking
getting
Amazon,
paid,
the post
you know,
office.
$12 an hour, $10 an hour. Those people at McDonald's are still only making $8.50, $9.50 an hour, and they're still showing up for work every day, and they're not able to be in the confines of their own house. So those are really unsung heroes, so thanks to them. And if you have the ability to stay at home, whether or not you're working from home or you're just staying out of harm's way and you have a home where you can stay out of harm's way, just be thankful that you have that, because there are lots of people that don't have that. And, you know, how'd you like to be someone who, hell, you know, the baristas at Starbucks are getting their full pay, you know, as they take their time off. Somebody at Jewel who's stacking the shelves full of toilet paper for 14 hours a day and is surrounded by a bunch of maniacs who are hoarding and not social distancing, and they're getting paid a little over minimum wage, they don't have that. They don't have that luxury. So I just want to say on the record, you know, thank you to them, because nobody's thanking them.
No, I definitely I agree. And all those people are huge necessities right now to make our lives still semi easy to deal with, because fuck, bro, think about this shit like being even like 15 years ago with no Amazon two-day delivery, no Instacart, no GoPuffs. What the fuck would you do? You would have stocked up for like $1,000 worth of groceries and been a prepper where like you would have had 1,000 rolls of toilet paper, because you wouldn't go to the store every day. You wouldn't have like a delivery service like catering to you, or restaurants still being open for curbside pickup. Those businesses would have been fucking defunct. They would have lost their shit. There would not be any saving. We should be very thankful that we're in a time, and, you know, with the technology offering those types of capabilities. But truth of the matter, man, I just sent you a link to a very powerful documentary about like the front lines of what they're going through in Bergamo, Italy. And Jesus Christ, did that open my eyes to, like, you know, obviously the doctors and the nurses and the people in the hospitals. But Jesus Christ, watch this documentary and it'll blow your mind. Like, these people are superheroes, just fucking superheroes. Like, everybody that I know that's a nurse or a doctor, I fucking love you, man, because that's some just fucking scary shit for 14, 18 hour shifts of just dealing with a disease that you could get at any moment. And I posted the link on my Facebook if anybody wants to go check it out. Roke, if you want to repost it or share it. But I think everybody needs to watch this, just because it's not like, oh my God, another depressing thing. But it was the most realistic, hands-on thing where this journalist went to Italy into the front lines, and he's like the only motherfucker in the streets. Like, this guy is literally him and the mayor of that town in Italy, which is the epic center of the horrible stuff that's happening in Italy, that is just like what they're fighting. And we're slowly starting to get there, and people are still fucking going to bars, going in and out of the house. Dude, my neighbors who fucking had 30 people over the Saturday of St. Patrick's Day weekend.
Oh, you texted me and you were pissed.
Because they didn't want to cancel. Yeah, because they didn't want to cancel the party because they planned it for a month. They're still fucking having people coming in and out of their house.
Well, you know what? You need to call the cops on them then.
I'm about to, bro.
I'm dead serious.
Hey, what's the rule? All right, so now you can play the thing. Does that audio clip say how many people should be per resident?
No, but the thing that Governor Pritzker did, I mean, you're not supposed to be in groups of more than 10. So, you know, if they're having groups of 10 or more over there at the house, you definitely could call the police on them. You could at the very least talk to the landlord about them and say, hey, I'm fearing for my safety because these people down the hall from me, you know, they're having parties and having a bunch of people come over. But let me.
Bro, they're flight attendants. They're flight attendants.
Oh. So not only that, they're traveling all over the country and all over the world and coming over.
You believe that shit? You believe that shit? Well, I'm more scared of doing my laundry, which is the area they all like walk through, rather than me taking a fucking walk or going to the store. Because at the store, I know if somebody coughs at me, I'm going to accidentally punch them in their neck. But here, I got to deal with doing my laundry, wondering whether somebody's sneezing on the fucking handle.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. So make sure that you've got, you know, your Lysol, you got your wipes, and, you know, don't be, you know, just make sure you wipe all that shit down every time, especially because you said you're dealing with flight attendants and stuff like that. So let me start to, let me play these clips for you. The first one is from Dr. Emily Landon. She's the executive medical director of infection prevention and control at the University of Chicago Medicine. She is an endocrinologist. And so she talks a little bit here about how you can catch the disease and a little bit of like what you were talking about, like going to the grocery store, wiping stuff down, things like that. So I want to play this for you. And then I want to, I'd love to hear you comment on this, please.
First of all, we need to, there's a lot of studies that are going to come out just like they would from any virus where they find viral particles in all sorts of places. But we have to stop for a minute and understand that there's a, with every infection, you have to get a certain number of viable viral particles or bacterial particles into you in the right place at the right time at the same time in order to cause infection. We call that the inoculum dose, the amount that it takes to make someone sick. For some infections, that number is very low, like just a few organisms would be enough.
Dano, this is important shit. You mind, you know, not pouring yourself a drink during it?
What a dick.
All I hear are ice cubes. Oh, he's pouring himself a bourbon. I stand corrected. Go right ahead.
I'm done.
Mixing
okay,
bourbon
I'm
with red wine?
Exactly.
Yes. You're mixing bourbon with red wine?
I know. Why all of a sudden now Claire's chipping in? She had nothing to say.
She hadn't said anything for the last 25 minutes. Now all of a sudden.
I didn't know you wanted me to join in.
Thanks a lot, Mom. All right.
I didn't know this was a three-way.
This is important. Back to the doctor.
For other infections, it's much more. For other coronaviruses, it's much, much more than what they're finding just ambiently in the air or on surfaces, not in a room of someone who is very sick with coronavirus.
Right.
So I think, plus, we don't even know if those viral particles in many of these studies are even alive anymore. Just finding little snippets of the RNA of the virus doesn't mean it can actually infect you. And these viruses are very, they are not the hardiest of viruses. Part of the reason that the test isn't perfect is because the virus can sometimes degrade completely before we even get to the testing, like to doing the actual test on the sample. So you have to have a lot there. So I think we need to know that the most important thing is to just keep your exposure as low as possible. I don't think that if you are at very high risk and you want to wipe down stuff in the grocery store, go for it. If you are limiting, you're going to the grocery store once in a while, you're picking stuff, you know, the grocery store is making sure not to have too many people inside at the same time. It doesn't appear as though there's a bunch of other sick people there. You know, keep your distance, take the measures that have been recommended to you. Certainly some healthcare providers, we are giving them guidance to do things like change their clothes when they come inside and put them directly in the wash. But they've been in a unit full of patients with coronavirus where we're doing all sorts of things to help them breathe better that spreads the virus even more. So that's a different situation than just going to the grocery store. And I think it's safe to go for a walk outside.
So that's an endocrinologist from the University of Chicago talking a little bit about this disease and some of the things you can do to not get it, prevent yourself to get it, what you do if you go to the grocery store, things like that. And a lot of this stuff, hopefully you knew already, but I think that maybe once you hear it in this context, where it's not just a 10, 15-second soundbite on the news or something you see on MSNBC or CNN, I mean, and this is part of, this was an hour and 45 minute conference video that I was a part of. And so this is just a little bit part of it. That was just 2 minutes of it. But hopefully that helped you with how you'll go about your daily business. You have any thoughts on that, Dano?
I'll be honest, man. You know me. Like, I'm pretty fucking OCD when it comes to cleaning my hands. After like touching stuff and just like being on the train, like the first thing I do getting into work, I would like clean my hands for a while. If I'm about to eat, I'm trying to make sure that my hands are clean. Like, I've been pretty anal when it comes to that. I had a horrendous like allergies when I was a kid. I'd be sick like 9 months out of the year. And when I started just cleaning my hands and doing different stuff, I just stopped getting as sick as often. So I kind of made it a lifestyle change. And I think that's what people are going to have to learn, is that it's going to be a new lifestyle change. Bro, there's not like, listen, you, I'm going to fucking hug and shake your hand, etc. But there's not going to be any more shaking of hands. Trump made that joke. There's not going to be any high fives. There's going to be fucking waves from like 5 feet, 10 feet away going forward. Like, this is a new lifestyle. And what that lady said is, you know, it's not common sense, but it's common sense going forward. I mean, you have to basically neutralize yourself to not be prone to getting these little particles that add up to hurt you. And, you know, some people don't get sick. Some people have a less amount of the sickness and they don't go through it too hard. But then there's people that are in their 20s, 30s, 40s that you read about that are soccer players, baseball coaches, and they just get fucking struck with it like there's no tomorrow.
Well, one of the reasons that I wanted to play this audio on the show is because there are a lot of people out there, and I'm not getting political, and I don't want this to be a political show, and it's not a political show, but there are a lot of people out there that think this is still fake news. They think that it's blown out of proportion. So I just wanted to have that on so that you have a doctor on. This is not a doctor that was talking on television. They were on Fox News or they were on CNN. So you think that they're skewed one way or they're skewed another way. This was just a Zoom, you know, town hall meeting. And this is just the facts. So I want you to have the facts. Now, one of the other some of the other facts that I want you to have are, well, what's going to happen now? We know that they passed that huge $2 trillion stimulus. What's in that stimulus bill? How does it affect me? Senator Dick Durbin was also part of this meeting, and here's what he had to say.
The second thing that we focused on was how to get money in the hands of people who need it. The president said, well, I'll send a check for $1,200 for each adult, $500 for each kid under the age of 17. We said, great idea, Mr. President. We don't quarrel with you, but it isn't enough. And one check, you know, one and done, is not going to do this. So we argued for dramatically increasing unemployment insurance, increasing the amount of payments over what the state ordinarily pays by $600 a week. $600 a week. And the idea is to make sure people can make their rent payments, pay the utility bills, pay the mortgage, put food on the table, and get by if they've been furloughed or laid off or lost their job if the company went out of business. $600 a week. We expanded the categories of people to part-time workers, the folks driving the Ubers as well as all these other cars, and we extended by 13 weeks the unemployment insurance that will be available. So that is kind of the first step in making sure that working and working families get some help. Now, what are we going to do about 50 to 60 million small businesses across America? Well, this was a powerful piece of this bill, and it was bipartisan, Rubio Republican, Cardin Democrat, I pitched in, everybody pitched in, we were all for it. Here's what it said. If you've got a business with fewer than 500 employees, and that applies to not-for-profits, that applies to charitable organizations as well, fewer than 500 employees, right, you can go and borrow your monthly payroll times 2.5. So let's assume your monthly payroll is $20,000. You could borrow 2.5 times that monthly payroll, $50,000, from a local bank through the SBA, and if you turn around and spend the money you borrowed on any of these things, payroll, benefits, utilities, or rent for your business, your loan's forgiven. You don't have to pay back that $50,000 if you can show you spent it on those things. Our idea behind that is to get these businesses to be able to get over this and be back in business when we start getting people out buying again. Now, there's help for bigger businesses, larger businesses by way of loans and a few grants, but the major part of it, I think, that we focused on was the small business part of it. Extra money for the states and the city of Chicago. We put in there that if you have more than 500,000 population as a city, and that's Chicago, or more than 500,000 as a county, that's Cook, that's Will, that's Lake, that's DuPage, those counties, there's one more, I guess it's McHenry. If you have all those people are going to get direct federal payments. The city of Chicago is hurting. We know it is. It was before because of pensions. It's been hurting more because of what the city's spending. So this will be money coming directly back to the city to be used for the expenses they're running into because of this situation.
Now, I was too cheap to actually pay for Zoom, so I have Zoom Basic. So we've got about 7 minutes left on this call. I'm getting a countdown. So
I have a question for you.
I want to make sure that I want to make sure you get to say your piece, your thoughts, Dano.
I got a question for you. So basically, I don't know if there was more to that Durbin conversation. So one thing that I have not heard anywhere or read, that extra $600 a week, is that after taxes? Is that gonna be taxed, or is that just straight $600 on top of the typical unemployment?
I don't know for sure. I do know that when you apply for unemployment, you can opt to have taxes federally and locally taken out of your unemployment check.
But see, I know that, man. Like, and that's what my struggle is with this shit, because it sounds good on paper. But having been on unemployment and fucking having the full amount, the full amount after taxes is like $353 a week. You're getting basically like $706 or $740, whatever it comes out to, every 2 weeks.
Every 2 weeks. You're getting like $1,400 a month, around there. But
yeah,
now,
so if you're getting $600 per week, that's another $1,200 on top of it. If you're like a typical Joe Schmo median salary, you're probably in that 22% bracket of taxes.
No, well, on the unemployment, and I know this because I was on the unemployment website just yesterday filing, it's 10% federal when you opt to have taxes taken out. It's 10% federal, 4% state.
All right, so
so take 15% off of the. So if you're getting $930 a week, take 15% off of that.
So is that how they're going to tax the $600 per week, or are they not going to tax it? Or is $600 after taxes? That's my question.
I don't
to
think.
Any
I don't think.
Official.
I don't think it's after taxes. I don't know for sure. I assume that if you have the taxes taken out, that
they'll pull it from that money too.
They'll pull it from that. They'll right, correct.
But I have an issue with that because essentially another $1,200 at a 50% tax rate is another it's
160
like 160 bucks off.
Yeah.
So you're getting an extra grand from the extra $1,000 from the government for every 2 weeks, which helps. But I mean, it's hard too, because, you know, that's an extra $200 that you need for bills. And unemployment barely gets certain people by. God help you if you have a mortgage and kids and shit like that. So I think it's very appreciative, and I think it's a phenomenal thing I've never heard happen on unemployment. So, you know, I'm not one to judge, but I think that nobody's literally clarified that, where my brother got laid off. I know fucking you and Claire got laid off. It's like, there's a lot of people in my inner circle that got affected by this shit. I'm on the fucking bend, you know, like, I don't know what my shit is in the next couple weeks. So it's, you know, I think more clarification would help with that type of shit.
Well, I mean, when I heard that they were giving an extra $600 a week, I thought that that was a misprint. I'm like, unemployment's only $330 a week. They're gonna give you
two times
that every week. So the fact that they're doing that at all, you know, is a good thing.
But that's also to stimulate the economy. That's just not for paying bills and whatever. They want people to go out and spend that money.
Yeah, but people are going to spend that money, unfortunately, on stupid shit. But you know what's cool is that people will be on unemployment for a year because they extended that shit, too. But, I mean, you know what? It's America, bro. Like, people are still going to buy TVs on that shit, and they're going to think that some people are going to make more money. Some people are going to make more money on the stimulus than they would in their regular jobs. Is that a bad thing? No, I get it. I mean, to Claire's point, I think that that's the thought process. But I think some people I hope that some people learned from 2008, 2009, fucking put some away for a rainy day. Because you know what, bro? From our experiences, bro, you know that shit. It ain't that easy to find a job under Trump or anything. You still have a 2 to 5 month window to try to fucking find a job. And it's a process.
Well, I mean, you're absolutely right. It's better than nothing. Most people only live for tomorrow anyway. And so people are going to have to start thinking down the road. They're going to have to start thinking 6 months down the road, thinking a year down the road. And, you know, you talked about it. You said it a few minutes ago. I mean, this is changing. This is going to change the way we live forever. And this is just one of those things. And what the government is essentially doing is paying you to stay at home. They're paying you to stay at home.
Yeah, sit down. Don't do anything stupid.
Listen, I've got a couple of other cuts that I'm going to play. One of them is about unemployment, but I've got a minute left before I lose the feed with you. So I just want to let you say your last word, Dan.
Hey, let's cut this. Yeah, man. No, let's cut this one, and then we'll do it again whenever you're available, and then we could play the next one. But I love you, man. Hopefully, just stay safe. Be smart. You know, wash your face. I heard also washing your face is huge nowadays, as weird as it sounds, and inside your nose because your hair follicles hold this shit. I think the government is trying to do certain things. I think Pritzker and Lightfoot have been doing a really good job for Chicago. I'm not going to speak of any other fucking politicians because I'm going to play Canada. But I think that our city is fighting as so we don't get to where New York is and where the epic center of Europe happened. And I'm scared of what's to come, but I'm also hopeful.
I think I'm about to lose your brother.
I want my close people to be healthy.
Stay safe, brother. Love you.
Love you.
Love you. Love you too, Claire. Dano with me, Claire. You're listening to Roker Radio. Al Roker Jr., thank you so much for joining me on this edition of Roker Radio. I want to play a couple of other things here very quickly before I go. And since we were just talking about unemployment, let's talk a little bit more about unemployment. Maybe that'll help to answer some of those questions, maybe help clear some things up. The next person you're going to hear from, her name is Ibie Hart. She's from the Illinois Department of Commerce and Economic Opportunity, and also Congresswoman Robin Kelly. And they are going to talk about specifically about unemployment, what you need to do, and exactly what you're going to get. Listen carefully.
So it would be IDS. Part of that is in the CARE Act. There is like an expansion of that. But if you just email me at ibiesandboyie.hart@illinois.gov, I can get you a direct link to your specific situation.
Yeah, and I don't know if Congresswoman Kelly, can you speak to the act on that specifically in terms
of... Well, everyone that gets unemployment, they should also get an additional $600 added to that. And, you know, I know that, you know, they should get $600 increase for everybody. And we waived the waiting period, so to get money in people's pockets even sooner by providing federal incentives for states to eliminate the waiting week. But then there's an extension of benefits, an additional 13 weeks of federally funded unemployment insurance benefits. And then there's an allowance for people who are really concerned about part-timers, self-employed, the gig economy workers, but they also, they have access to it also. And just people that get 1099.
And that's huge because those people usually are not eligible for unemployment insurance. So now, what does that mean? That means that all the independent contractors, all the people who got 1099, the Uber drivers, the Lyft drivers, you know, and hey, a lot of my friends in radio are like me and don't have full-time radio gigs. They have part-time radio gigs, or they're independent contractors that do shows or radio stations or whatever. Those people now can file for unemployment. IDES, the Illinois Department of Employment Security. So just Google IDES, and that will take you to the page. Having been on that page, and my wife having been on that page in the last week, I'll give you a couple of tips. One, they are so busy that they're having people file for unemployment based on their last name. So it's like A through M is, you know, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and N through Z is Tuesday, Thursday, Sunday, or something like that. You'll see it when you go to the website. So that's one. Two, the best thing to do is to do it during off hours. If you try and get on that website at noon, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I don't think you're going to have a lot of success. If you can set your alarm, get up early, and get on that website at 6 o'clock in the morning, or get on the website before you go to bed at night, you're going to have a lot more success filing for unemployment. Also, the website is down every night between 8 p.m. and 10 p.m. So that's just so you know. A couple more things before I go. And if you've listened to Roker Radio, you've heard me do a lot of shows from Sheffield's, from Shamrock Club, from different restaurants. And, of course, all of those are closed. And maybe some of the restaurants, the bars are certainly closed. Some of the restaurants are doing carry out and delivery. And please support them as best you can, because they're trying to keep their businesses afloat through this whole thing so that they have a business when we get to the other side. But this next clip is for you if you have any type of small business. This is very important for you to listen to before you lay off any of your workers, because they have some very special loans and even grants in some cases, for small business that they have designed for you so that you don't have to lay off your workers. So if you own a small business, bar, restaurant, any type of small business, before you lay any of your workers off, listen to this. Once again, this is Ibie Hart from the Illinois Department of Commerce and Economic Opportunity.
The biggest package that came in is SBA disaster loan. And what it is that you can have, you can ask for a loan of up to $2 million, up to $25,000 without collateral. After $25,000, you would need collateral. And the reason why I think this is such a great loan program is because it's not even really a loan. And that's, you can say that I said that. And that's because the first payment is in 12 months and your repayment term can be up to 30 years. And they've like never written policy like this before, but ultimately what they're saying is, if you speak to what your financial loss is in this time that COVID is happening and your businesses are shut down, ask for that amount of money in the period of time that, let's say it's like 2 to 3 months at this point, if we just look long term, and that's a quarter. You can look at your past quarter, January through March, last year's quarter, and then ask for that amount. And like our office fully believes that in 12 months, when you're making your first payment, not the full payment, your first payment, you should be able to make that first payment in 12 months. And then the full thing isn't due for up to 30 years. So it's a really, really progressive loan program. And also they just made a change that if you apply for this loan, you get an advance of $10,000 within 3 days. And whether you qualify for that loan or not, you get the loan or not after the process, you do not have to repay that $10,000.
So did you catch that? So what you can do is apply for these loans and these grants, even if you don't get the big loan, say you need a $50,000, $100,000, $200,000 loan, you can apply and get a $10,000 loan and not have to pay that money back. So that is essentially a grant. And they are also have different loans and grants that they're basically paying you so that you can continue to pay your workers with that payroll. You know, you get that money and you use it to pay for your payroll. Dick Durbin talked about it. It was the first cut that I played. And you can use that to pay your utilities, pay your vendors, pay your payroll, and then you don't have to pay that money back. Well, why are they doing that? Well, if you can keep your employees employed, then A, they don't have to go on unemployment, which costs the government more. And B, your business can be up and running when we get to the other side, which jumpstarts the economy when we get to the other side. So just to quickly recap, and please, if you're listening to this and any of this information is helpful to you, or you know any of this information will be helpful to a friend of yours, please let them know about Roker Radio on Spotify and on Apple Podcasts. But you've got the stimulus bill, so everyone is going to get a $1,200 check. Married couples will get $2,400. Plus, you'll get $500 for every child. And that is up to if you make $75,000 a year. As far as the virus itself, if you're high risk and what you feel comfortable with is, you know, wiping down the bags, wiping down the to-go containers, wiping down the Amazon box, by all means, continue to do so. But make sure that you keep doing social distancing. Make sure you cover your mouth when you sneeze, when you cough. And really the most important thing is to stay home. Just stay home. Because a lot of people have this and don't know that they have it. And they go out and they infect people. And the problem that we're going to end up having is, even if we have the ventilators, even if we have the masks, even if we have the ICU beds, even if we have the tests, we may not have enough medical workers to administer the tests or take care of us or our loved ones if they continue to get sick because they've been infected. And if a lot of people go out and get infected because somebody went out to get a burger and didn't know they were infected, and they end up infecting 4 people, and it overloads the system, then we all lose. Okay? Final thought, and thank you for listening, as always. Roker Radio, alrokerjr.com. Please let me know what you think. Talk to me. I'll get back to you. Social media, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, at Al Roker Jr. And again, if this information helps you or you know anybody who can be helped by some of this information that we've passed along today, please just tell them to subscribe to Roker Radio on Apple Podcasts or on Spotify. And as I leave you, I'm going to leave you with my buddy, comedian Tom Dreesen, who has been giving a little bit of drops of wisdom on his Facebook page every now and then as he tries to keep all of us laughing and happy and looking on the bright side. I want to end this edition of Roker Radio with a thought from my buddy, comedian Tom Dreesen. Thank you again for listening. As always, please, hashtag flatten the curve, hashtag stay home, stay safe, save lives. I'll talk to you soon. Peace.
Hi, it's Tom Dreesen, and I'm on my 753rd day of lockdown. anyhow, that's what it feels like. But I was thinking about being shut in like this for you folks out there who have small children at home. This might be a great time for you to teach them the greatest gift that God can bestow upon a human being, and that's a sense of humor. Now, a sense of humor, by my humble definition, is not when you have the ability to laugh at others' shortcomings and misfortunes. It's when you have the ability to laugh at your own. Psychiatrists would probably tell you that the biggest problem most of their patients have is that we take ourselves too serious. We don't laugh at ourselves enough. And you can teach children a sense of humor. And the way you do that is start telling them stories now about when dumb things that you did when you were growing up, or dumb things that you just did yesterday, or silly things you said that you shouldn't have said, and laugh at yourself in front of them. That teaches them that they too can laugh at themselves, and they'll be so much happier in life if they have this sense of humor. You guys out there might find this interesting. I was on a show called Hollywood Squares years ago, and a question was asked of 3,500 women polled, what's the number one characteristic they look for in a man? And the answer was a sense of humor. A man who could laugh at himself, a man who didn't take himself too serious. If you can find someone in your life that makes you laugh and it turns out to be your spouse, you're a very, very rich person. I want to share one more story with you, what I think exemplifies a great sense of humor. It was another show that I was on called The Merv Griffin Show, and there was an actress on the show with me. Her name was Ruth Gordon, and you old-timers might remember her. But she went on stage when she was 18 years old. She went on Broadway when she was 18 years old, and she was acting up until she was almost 90 when she passed away. At age 72, she won the Academy Award in a movie called Rosemary's Baby. But Merv said to her, Ruth, you're a brilliant actress, and I'm honored to have you on this show, but I looked up your reviews when you first went on Broadway, and this is what they said. Your review said, she has no stage presence, she's not pretty, and she can't act. He said, how in the world did you survive? She said, I ignored the facts. Teach your children a sense of humor. They'll be so much, so much happier in life because of that.